With the recent terrorist attacks in the United Kingdom, I thought it might be prudent to do that, to do a talk on that as part of my Whitsuntide broadcast for Pentecost, but I never got round to it, so I'm going to do the same theme but for Trinity instead. So this is my first Trinity broadcast, and I want to try and answer two distinct questions. The first question is, why do we bless our enemies? Why is that what we're commanded to do? And the second question is, why is it that based on the past, based on what you read in the Old Testament, why is it that God would never sanction the sort of terrorist activities that you now see from, you know, extremists? And I'll do my best to answer both of those from a sort of theological point of view. And I would be interested as well if anybody could sort of provide more of a scriptural basis, but I'm basing it on the scripture, obviously, but it's more of a theological, you know, if these are the scriptural premises, then it follows that, rather than a case of it written, you know, clearly. So the first, to understand the first, the answer to the first question, you first have to understand a few things about the divine and what sort of God's nature is all about. If you are a perfect being, you cannot stand the sight of anything that is imperfect. In fact, it's a bit like an impulsive reaction. If you fly too close to the sun in your spaceship, you get burned up. That's not the sun's fault. The sun is just simply a nuclear reactor that gives out a lot of heat. And, you know, if you get too close to it, you will burn up. A similar thing can be sort of said for the imperfect when they come into contact with the perfect. The perfect cannot tolerate the imperfect, because in order to be perfect, they have to be completely pure. It's what we call God's holy nature. And we are not holy at all. However, when we are Christians, we get the indwelling of the Spirit, and so we get a part of God in us. And when he sees us, he sees his reflection. Really, he sees that which is in us, that is changing us, that will eventually make us holy, you know, after we've died. So that's why, you know, if you ask for a blessing on somebody who is already a Christian, it's a good positive thing. It brings them good positive things. The same is actually not true for those that are not saved. Those that are not saved are imperfect, and if you are asking for a blessing on them, you're asking for, in some way, God to reveal himself to them. Now, that is asking for them to come into close proximity with something that is holy, without the protection of having part of God inside them, okay? There's no protection for them against, you know, their sin and their imperfectness in that sort of environment. When this happens en masse, and it has happened en masse before, it has caused extreme trauma, is the only way to say it, to those individuals unlucky enough, I suppose, to be blessed when they are not saved. This happens in what is called a sort of revival situation. There are stories of, you know, a group of Christians that get together and pray for, you know, God to reveal himself to people. And suddenly normal everyday people outside in the street who are not Christian have visions of hell opening up underneath them, of all sorts, and they're flooding into the churches to try and answer what's going on. And that's twofold. First, there's an element there where this blessing is not good necessarily immediately for the person involved. It might be frightening, it might be scary, because they're coming face to face with something that's perfect when they are not. And secondly, what it does is it gives the possibility for them then to understand and be saved. It's a case of punishment followed by rehabilitation. They do in some way pay, but then after that they are more likely to understand what has happened and come to see the truth, and then they're saved. So it's a win-win situation for everyone, really. And I think that's one of the reasons why it's commanded. We're not praying for them to be successful. We're not praying blessings on their motives or on what they are doing. We're praying for them to be shown the error of their ways by the Almighty, and that's not going to be a pleasant thing for them initially. So I think that's why it's commanded, and I think that's what it's all about. The second question is that the motivation of these people is that, you know, basically God has told them to do this. By doing this, they are rewarded in heaven because they are following God's, you know, what God has said. Now, it is true in the Old Testament that God did sanction mass murder. That is absolutely true. There is a reason why he no longer acts like that. And to understand this, you have to understand the whole thing about what Judaism is. When people think about Judaism, they think it's a faith. They think it's a religion. It's not a religion, okay? It's actually a group of people who are related by blood, so it's a family, and they have been specially chosen by God out of the human population. Okay, they alone are capable of being saved. The offer of salvation isn't being made to all human beings. It's only being made to the chosen ones, basically. And the method by which these chosen ones have to be saved is a personal redemption through the law. Now, the whole thing is a little bit of a setup, because unfortunately, in order to be self-redeeming, you have to perfectly follow the law, which is impossible to perfectly follow unless you are perfect in the first place. And that is the lesson of the Old Testament. And that's not to say that nobody, therefore, was saved before Christ, because he says that some of the Jews are saved by righteousness. They are credited with righteousness. And whether that's because they are devout in their following, or what, we don't really know. There isn't a specific sort of criteria. And that's why I also wonder whether there are people in other faiths who can be saved by being credited with righteousness. That is a theory. I would not dare presume that to be the truth at all. But I wonder if sometimes really devout followers of whatever religion may be saved through their following of it, their devoutness, rather than anything else. The only way to be absolutely sure is basically to be Christian. Now, why does that mean that God suddenly doesn't act like that? Well, When Jesus was sacrificed, God extended his gift of salvation to the entire population of the planet. You know, until that point, the only thing that had been really important to him was the Jews, and therefore, you know, as it was his creation in the first place, he was free to create and destroy as he wanted, because the only thing that was of lasting importance to him was the Jews at the time. And that's not the case now. The case now is that anyone could be, has the potential to be saved, because anybody can ask for the indwelling, you know, come to repentance and be saved. Therefore, he cannot act in a manner that some lives can be taken because they don't matter, because they're just, you know, they're just things that he created that he can destroy. He can't act like that, because now the same level of chosen that he gave to the Jews, that he would move mountains for, he would destroy other civilizations for, has been transferred to everybody. And so there is nobody left now that doesn't matter, if that makes sense. And so he's unlikely, isn't he, based on that, to order mass executions or acts of terror against the innocent or anything like that. Because he's offered salvation to everybody, and everybody has the ability to take that up. And so nobody is sort of worthless in that respect, if you know what I mean. It gives a very harsh view of God as the Old Testament. And the problem, I think, with Islam is that it still has a God of the Old Testament. It still has a God that's very, that has a chosen, rather than viewing the whole of mankind as a possible chosen, depending on whether they accept or reject. You know, the offer is now that we accept or reject, rather than God chooses one particular race. And so you're not going to get a Christian response that says, oh yes, you know, God either didn't really massacre people in the first place, or he's changed his mind. It's not a case of changing his mind, it's a case of the situation has changed. You know, he is still dealing with his chosen exactly the same way. The only difference is we are all his chosen now, rather than just one group of people. And therefore, you know, the rules of, you know, using one nation, for example, to penalise the Jews when they've gone wrong, has to be false. To say that the Jews can just claim a piece of land and kill everybody in it has to be false, because the chosen race, if you like, is now all of humanity. All of humanity has been given that offer. And so his dealings, whilst they appear to have changed, he hasn't changed his mind at all. He's just extended the envelope so that it doesn't just now cover the Jews, but it covers everyone. And in so doing, he's now made it pretty much impossible to sanction, you know, mass murder, genocide, stuff like that, because he hasn't, his chosen is not limited to a couple of people against any mass. It's, his chosen is now everybody, and therefore everybody is safe, if you like. There's nobody to make the example out of by, you know, killing them or whatever. At least that's what I think, and I'd be interested if people had other views. I'd be very interested in hearing them, because, as I say, that's not as fixed a view as I've maybe presented it, and it's more based on a theological argument than anything that's, you know, 100% scriptural. So if anybody does have any feelings on that, feel free to share.